Hello. Hello and welcome to the Mike Lazaridis Theater of Ideas here at Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And welcome to the Perimeter Institute Public Lecture Series presented by Sun Life Financial. My name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is my sincere pleasure to welcome everyone here today, both those of you here in the live studio audience and those of you watching online, either on Perimeter's website or on one of our many science communication colleague websites around the globe. The lecture itself will last approximately 1 hour, and there will be time for question and answer at the end. And for those of you online, Dr. Damian Pope and Dr. Kelly Foyle are in the chat zone with a team of PI researchers behind their keyboards, ready to engage in conversation. They're going to supply you with extra resources to help you grapple with the complexities of particle physics and of the LHC at CERN. And they will also be remaining online and active for 30 minutes after the lecture. So if you have those burning questions, you'll be able to get them answered. And also, I will take a question or two for our guest speaker via the Twitter feed. If you want to join any of that discussion online, please use hashtag PILive. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's very special guest speaker, Dr. Jonathan Butterworth. Dr. Butterworth is the head of the Department of Physics of Astronomy at the University College in London. Dr. Butterworth obtained his doctorate in physics from Oxford University. He worked with Penn State University on the Hera Electron-Proton Collider in Hamburg, Germany, before moving to University College in 1995, eventually rising to become one of the leading members of the ATLAS collaboration at CERN. Author of the book Most Wanted Particle, he is also a regular contributor to The Guardian and a winner of a list of prestigious prizes, most recently the Chadwick Prize in 2013 for the Institute of Physics. Tonight, he will provide us with an inside look, presenting his own personal account of what it's like to work on the world's most complicated machine and largest experiment, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Jonathan Butterworth.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak here at this great place. Now is a very exciting time to be a physicist. And a lot of that has got to do with a machine called the Large Hadron Collider that I work on, which is at CERN in Geneva in Switzerland. And a lot of that has to do with a thing called the Higgs boson, which you may have heard we found in 2012, we announced the discovery. Those are a few simple sentences to string together. I hope over the next hour or so to give you an idea of why finding a new particle is interesting, how we did it, and what we might do next. And that really revolves around this. This is the view that I would get being based in London, having kids in school in London, but doing all my research in Geneva. This is a view that I would get about twice a week when the thing was running through 2009, 10, 11, into 12. And I was leading one of the research groups there. This is the view as you approach CERN over the Jura Mountains. You see Mont Blanc on the horizon there, highest mountain in Europe, apart from one in the Urals, actually, I think, but one of the highest anyway. And Lake Geneva here. And then this yellow ring here, which, of course, you wouldn't actually see on the ground because the farmers wouldn't let us. But this marks the path of the Large Hadron Collider. It marks the path where there's a tunnel 27 kilometers around, under the ground, with the two highest energy beams of particles that we've ever managed to get together in a lab, going around it in opposite directions and coming into head-on collision at four points on the ring. One of them here, CMS, one of them at LHCb, one of them at ATLAS, and one of them at ALICE. And at each of those points, we bring the beams into collision and we try and work out what they're telling us about the way the universe works and what things are made of. It's been in the news quite a lot, or it certainly was when it was running and discovering the Higgs, and actually we're restarting probably over Easter weekend, actually, just to destroy all our holidays. It's restarting any day now, actually, at higher energies than before, and I'll come back to what we might learn from that and, in the next few years later in the talk. But one of the interesting and sometimes frustrating things about science making news is that the new thing is often rather obscure and rather difficult to understand and rather out there, disconnected from the rest of knowledge, because in fact, truth be told, to many, much of the audience and certainly many of the journalists involved, often the whole of 20th century physics is news. So to be out there discussing the edges of string theory or the discovery of the Higgs or something, it feels a little out of context sometimes because you don't get the idea that science is actually built of incremental steps built on everyday experience. And it's just really a method for taking common sense as far as you can, and it's got us as far as a Higgs boson. One of the ways I like to try and connect it back is to answer the question, why is this machine so big? Why do I have to go to Geneva? Why can't we build one in London? Why can't you have one here? Well, we can't have one. There can only be one because it's so big and therefore expensive, and it needs to be so big because we want to go to high energy. Now, I'll come back to why we want to go to high energy later, but the reason that to go to high energy you need a big circle is quite easy. It's the same reason that you have to slow down when you turn a corner in a car. Newton's laws say that things will go in a straight line unless they're acted on by a force. If you want to turn a car around a corner, the force is going to come from the friction between the wheels and the road. And if you don't slow down, you'll skid. The two things that set the maximum speed you can go around the corner are the maximum friction between the road and the wheels. So if it's raining, you have to go slower. So that's the maximum force that can be exerted to turn you around the corner. And the next thing is how sharp is the corner. And between them, those things will say, how fast can you go around that corner? It's exactly the same with us. These beams of particles want to go in a straight line more than any other particle we've ever had in a lab. So we pack this tunnel with the strongest bending magnets we can build. And then once we've done that, the thing that says how high in energy can you go is how sharp is the curve. You want a very gentle curve, which means, unfortunately, a very big ring, 27 kilometers around. But that's basically it. That's why it's so big. So although, you know, I'm not kidding you, the science and some of what we're doing here is very abstruse and quite on the edge, but it's built on bits of knowledge and engineering and science and physics that, like that. Just to set the scale of this, I'm not sure it really helps, but I'm going to try. This 27 kilometers, you can fit the whole of central London in that. Okay? I mean, London, England, not Ontario, right? actually, the circle line, the inner tube line in London is 27 kilometers round, and that's basically it. So it's very, very big. So having gone to all that effort to bring these beams into collision, what we want to do then is, of course, detect everything we possibly can about what happens there. And as I said, we build these colliders there. These detectors are these four points. You can think of them essentially as very, very big, fast, and high-resolution digital cameras, if you like, that is taking pictures of these collisions. There are four great experiments on there. I'm only going to talk about results from ATLAS and CMS because those are the experiments that we call general-purpose detectors. They're the ones that were involved in the hunt for the Higgs boson. But I will give now honorable mention to ALIS and LHCb. They're more specialized. They're looking at more detailed, other more specialized areas of physics. In fact, I'll refer to LHCb again later, I think. But for now, remember, I'm going to focus on ATLAS and CMS. Before I talk about the detectors, though, I wanted to say something about the organization. So CERN stands for Centre Européen de Recherche Nucléaire, which is the only French I'm going to even attempt, I'm afraid. But it's the European Centre for Nuclear Research. In fact, it's subnuclear research now. It's particle physics. It was founded just over 60 years ago in 1954 to sort of recover the European collaborative leadership in science, which had been very strong before the Second World War and was completely devastated by the Second World War. Many people died, many people moved over to the United States, and which was clearly in the ascendancy then in terms of this physics. And so CERN was set up in the middle of Europe, in Geneva, to try and rebuild this collaboration, explicitly non-military, explicitly not meant to do economically beneficial stuff particularly, although it occasionally happens. But there to just rebuild European basic science. And it took quite a long time, but it worked. The European taxpayer for the last few decades has been spending the equivalent of about $3 per year on the collaboration, which is not a lot of money per person compared to Other things the government spend money on, but it adds up to a lot of money. And maybe even more importantly, it's consistent. It's a multinational agreement that is very hard to change, so it doesn't fluctuate hugely. I mean, every year we have a huge argument about the budget, but it's about deltas, not about whether there should be one or not. So these are the current member states. The UK was one of the founding members. It's nothing to do with the European Union. You can see it sort of overlaps with it in some places, but not in others. But these are the current 21 member states. And over the last few decades, in the last 61 years, it's built up an infrastructure, a reputation, a skill base that means that now it's much, much bigger than that. And this is basically where the world comes to do this energy frontier physics. Every country that's not grayed out here has some relationship with CERN, ranging from just they send some postdocs or students there to train, or they're a full member and everything in between. You can see that Canada has a cooperation agreement. In fact, this is even out of date because a couple of months ago, Mongolia signed a cooperation agreement as well. So it's really a global enterprise now. Okay, so that was the organization. Now back to these digital cameras, these detectors. This is an engineering drawing of the Atlas detector, which is the one I work on and help to build. In the UK, we built some of the stuff in the heart of it, but the things to say about this then. This is you can see it's got this kind of general cylindrical structure with the beam going through the middle of the cylinder, or two beams, and they collide in the middle here. And most of the protons actually miss and come round for another go, but some of them collide in the middle there. What else to say about it? Well, it's quite big. If you haven't spotted them, these are people. So it gives you some idea of the scale. It's a huge thing. And each one of these cylinders is a different technology trying to tell us something that's designed to tell us something different about these collisions that we work so hard to get. So in the middle, for instance, there's a semiconductor detector. Semiconductors, as the name suggests, they're almost conductors of electricity. In fact, they don't have any free electrons, so they're not conducting electricity, but they have a band of energy, an allowed space the electrons can be, that if you give an electron a tiny amount of energy, it can suddenly be free to travel through the whole material rather than being bound to one atom. And that they're used all the time. It's a very useful thing. This screen, this computer, practically everything, all technology is based on these things now. But what we use them for is fairly dumb. We just want to fill the electrons that are all there, we're not quite able to carry current. And if a particle goes past them, it can give them a tiny amount of energy, suddenly free them up, and then suddenly they can be read out by a voltage, and you can tell that the particle went by. And it's a really nice non-invasive or almost non-invasive way of detecting the particle went by, because the amount of energy it has to give an electron to free it is tiny. So that's great. So charged particles, any particle that's produced with an electrical charge can do that. And there's also a magnetic field around that, so that if the amount that they bend in the magnetic field, same physics as the bending the beams in the LHC, in fact. The low energy particles will bend more, the high energy particles will be more straight. Outside of that, we have this blob here is a calorimeter. Calorimeter, it measures energy, as the name suggests there. It's just very, very dense, and it's designed to stop everything that hits it, even the neutral particles, which up until that point will not have been measured. And then these huge wheels on the outside that you see here, and this stuff around the edge of the cylinder, is actually there just to detect one kind of particle, which is called the muon. A muon is like an electron, but heavier, so it decays, actually, two electrons after a very short while, but it lives long enough to get out of the detector. So if particles, charged particles that register in the muon detectors are muons, and muons are not, because they decay so quickly, they're not found commonly in nature. In fact, that's not quite true. There's a few of them in this room now passing through us from cosmic rays in the upper atmosphere, but they don't live very long, so they're not in everyday matter. So if we make one in a proton-proton collision, it could be a sign something interesting happened, and you'll see that they feature in the Higgs discovery later. Okay, so that's Atlas. I've put this in here anyway because there's a fair chance that a lot of you have seen this picture at some point. This is when it was being built. This is actually from 2005. This is one of the people that was building it. I go and give this kind of talk quite often in schools in England, actually, and very often, it's just lovely how often this picture is on the wall somewhere in the classroom, because somehow this picture is symbolic of the fact that a lot of people got nearly as excited as we were about this experiment. The way we represent the collisions, or one of the ways we represent them, is like this. And believe it or not, from this picture, given what I've told you now, you can actually understand, you can start being a particle physicist almost. You can start understanding something about what's going on in this event. So let's concentrate on this. This is three different projections of the same event. So this one, and this one. Let's concentrate on this one. It's that cylinder that I showed you, that detector that I showed you before, but it's been sliced through. So you've got to imagine one of the beams coming from the projector, the other one coming from behind the screen. They collide in the plane of the screen here, and lots of stuff is made. Now, because of what I've already told you, you can tell quite a lot about this collision. First of all, you can tell that these gray particles here, they're bending quite a lot in the magnetic field, so they're quite low energy. In fact, they're not terribly interesting, and I'll come to that in a minute. But you can tell that these yellow ones here, not just because they're yellow, we did that as cheating, we colored them in. But even if they weren't yellow, you could tell they were special. And there were two reasons you can tell they're special. One is they're very straight, so they're very high energy. They're not being bent much by the magnetic field. The other is that they punch right through the Hall detector and register in the muon chambers. So the clue's in the name, they must be muons. Okay. So now, if you look at the next projection of this collision here, this is the same event, the same cylinder sliced the other way, so the beam's going along here and here, colliding at the red spot in the middle. And you zoom in, and this is what you see. And you can see that there's a lot going on here. The protons do not come one at a time. If they came one at a time, or one pair at a time, we'd have to wait forever to collect enough collision data to find anything out. Actually, neither do they come in a continuous stream. They come in little bunches, so tightly packed bunches, thinner than a human hair, and about 2 centimeters long, packed with billions of protons passing through each other, and a few of them will collide with each other, and we'll register what happens. Here you can see, actually, every one of these ellipses is a separate pair of protons that have collided. One here, 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 so on. There's about 12 of them here. We get more than that, actually, now. And we will do when it starts up again, and we did before it shut down. And in fact, all we'd want to save in this is this one, because this is where the muons come from. You see, they both come from the same collision. In fact, these muons are a Z boson, which is something, well, probably a Z boson anyway, which come from the decay of a Z boson, which I'll come to later in the talk. But just to, one of the reasons for showing this picture, partly because you've learned a lot about this collision just from what I've told you about the detector already, but the other thing is to give you some idea of the scale of the data. So the speed of light is 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second, which is 30 centimeters per nanosecond. A nanosecond is a billionth of a second. Nanosecond is a good unit to measure them in, because we have a bunch of protons passing through each other every 25 nanoseconds. Okay? So if you think about it, and you think how big the detector is, about 50 meters long, there is no way that all these particles can even have got out of the detector before the next lot are coming 25 nanoseconds later, even if they're all traveling at the speed of light, and they're not traveling any faster than that. So they're coming out in waves, concentric waves of particles. And that's even if they have to get out of the detector, but the electrical signals, the detectors have to register them, the signals go down the wires, none of that happens faster than the speed of light. So there's this huge asynchronous data problem going on, with this data being generated at an enormous rate. A lot of it that we don't want, like most of these gray tracks, some of it we really, really want and is the point of the whole experiment. And that all has to be kind of, some of it's processed and filtered online immediately in a kind of office block full of computers next to the experiment. But then it's farmed out all around the world on what's called a worldwide computing grid, and you have one of them here in Canada, these tier one centers, and eventually it's farmed out to the universities and eventually ends up on my laptop, some of it anyway, and we can do science with it. So that's the kind of infrastructure that's going on. And when it's running, it runs 24/7 around the clock, and the whole of that, the international collaboration gets all of the data from all of the experiment, even though they all built bits of it. All those bits have to work together, and then everyone gets the data from the whole thing. Okay. So I told you, I hope understandably, why if you want high energy, you need a big machine. I didn't really say why you need high energy. There are quite a few ways of describing why high energy physics is interesting, why it can tell us new things about the way the universe works. You hear people talk about we're studying the physics of the early universe, and there's some truth in that. When the universe was smaller and very hot and dense, then all the particles were zooming around very fast, and we're hitting each other all the time with the kind of energies that we're giving these protons to hit each other with. So it's true. I'm not so keen on that. It makes me sound like some kind of archaeologist or historian, because I think we're studying physics of now as well, not just the early universe. But it's fair, it works. Also, E equals mc squared. Energy is mass times the speed of light squared. If you want to find a new particle with some mass, you need a lot of energy to make it because c squared is a big number. That's also true. That doesn't really tell you why it's interesting to find new particles, though. I think there's a bit more missing there. My justification to myself, what I think I'm doing, is I'm studying the structure of matter of the universe, of what we're made of, and the laws that make it tick more closely than anyone's ever been able to do before. And I have a little video to illustrate that, which involves a ripple tank. So, if I can find the cursor, what you're going to see here is my friend Herbie's analogy for the Atlas detector that he filmed for me. So you're going to see, I want you to imagine that this is the beam of protons coming across here, trying to find out what's in the tank. And this is the Atlas detector over here, trying to work out what's in the tank from what happens to the waves, okay? You see that waves and particles, you have to trust me, they're roughly the same thing for quantum mechanics. So think of these waves as being the protons looking at each other. Someone's put a blob in there, you could tell it was there, okay? It's perturbed the waves, Atlas would register a dead zone here. If you're lucky, you could even work out roughly how big it was, maybe even what shape it was. Someone's going to put another blob in there. And now something bad has happened. You can't see it at all. There's no change here. The waves have reformed around it. The reason for that is that the distance between the peaks and the troughs of the waves is bigger than the size of the blob. What they're doing now is cranking up the energy, shortening the wavelength, and now you can see it again, see? You can tell that it's there. And that's because the waves have got short enough that the wavelength's now smaller than the size of the thing you're trying to see. So what that tells you, thank you, Herbie, for making that. What that tells you is if you want to, it's illustrating the fact that if you want to see very small things, you need very short wavelengths. And if you want very short wavelengths, you need very high energy because you need very high frequency. And that's the name of the game. So if our eyes, for example, were sensitive to radar, which has a wavelength of meters, they'd be great for seeing aeroplanes and boats, but they'd be terrible for seeing each other because we're too small for that. Our eyes use optical wavelengths, hundreds of nanometers. That's great for seeing some pretty small stuff, certainly good enough for seeing everyday life. If you want to see smaller than that, you go up in energy, you go to X-rays, or you go to electron microscopes. The LHC is just at the end of that chain. That's as far as we've got with the best microscopes we can. Remember, we're not looking just inside the electron. We're not even looking just inside the nucleus. We're looking inside protons, and we might even be looking inside quarks and electrons and stuff, if there's anything inside them. And that's where we start to get to where the Higgs comes in. This slide is going to be a lot in this talk because it's the sum of our knowledge of fundamental physics at some level. Now, first of all, fundamental physics is one of those terms. These are what we call fundamental particles. It sounds very grand to talk about fundamental particles. In a sense, maybe it is, but really all we mean by it is we haven't broken them yet. As far as we know, they're infinitely small. We've known about the electron for more than 100 years, and despite our best efforts, we haven't found anything inside it or smash one up. And believe me, we tried. So these particles here, the claim is that this stuff that's on this board, and I'll go through what it is in a minute, is what everything else in the universe is made of, and that this is not made of anything else. That's really quite a bold statement, okay? So what we've got here is we've got the quarks here and what we call leptons here. Up and the down quark make up the proton and the neutron. The electron was the first of these guys to be discovered, and it's fairly familiar, carries electric currents and things. Between them, the up and the down quark and the electron make atoms, which is quite an important job. And then there are neutrinos. They're a bit mysterious. They don't interact much with everyday matter, but they are produced in beta decays, radioactivity. They're produced by the sun a lot. There's billions of them in this room, but they kind of ignore us and pass right through. And then, for some reason, the whole pattern is copied three times. We don't know the reason for that. We know it's true. We've measured all those particles, and we've also shown definitively that if there is another copy of this, it's very, very different. There isn't really a similar copy, because we'd have found it by now. So that's kind of the periodic table of particle physics, if you like. And then on this side, you've got the way these guys interact with each other. So the photon here is how you're seeing me now. It's the particle of light, the quanta of light. But it also carries the electromagnetic force. The gluon carries a strong nuclear force, which is what binds nuclei together and binds the quarks inside the protons and neutrons. And then the W and the Z boson carry the weak nuclear force. The weak nuclear force is what does beta radioactive decays, for instance. It's absolutely critical in the interactions in the sun, and it's how the neutrinos are produced. But it only operates on very short distances. You don't see much of it in everyday life. It's really going on inside the nucleus is where it operates. But that's that, and the claim is that's it. That's what works. And it does work. It works extremely well. But there's a big problem with it, though, and it's actually... It came up in a question. I think I gave a talk like this in a school. And someone said, I'm paraphrasing, I'm probably making it sound a bit more physics-y than it really was, but if something is infinitely small and not made of anything else, how can it actually be anything? How can it have mass, for instance? And that's kind of a naive question on the one hand, and it's a very difficult question to answer on the other, within the theory. And that may sound like a surprise, but the mass of the proton, of the neutron, and therefore most of our mass and most of the mass of everyday material, we know where that comes from, actually. It comes from the fact that quarks are bound inside the proton very tightly. They're zooming around very fast, bouncing off the walls, if you like, inside the proton. And so they have a lot of energy. And that energy, via E equals mc squared, gives them a lot of mass. You can rearrange it. You know, the mass is can I rearrange it live? mass is E over C squared, see? So there is mass there, and most of the mass in the universe of you and I in this room comes from that. That only works because the proton's made of something else, but we know the quarks have got mass. In fact, the top quark has got a huge amount of mass, much more than 170-odd times the mass of the proton. The electron has mass, and it's not made of anything else, so that model of mass doesn't work. And in fact, this is a very general question. There's a big problem with giving things mass. It breaks the symmetries of the theories people were building to describe the standard model, which lie behind the standard model. And it's just a difficult question to answer. You could imagine we're going down, you know, it's kind of like the cosmic onion, I guess, going down and down in scale, and every time you find a new layer of substructure and you break up and you find a new layer. If that stops anywhere and the thing has mass, you have a problem. And in fact, in the early 60s, even before we knew about quarks, François Englert, Robert Brout, Peter Higgs were worrying about exactly that problem. Not about, as I say, we didn't know this list of particles then, but they could see that that was going to be a problem for the kind of theories we know how to build. How do you give something that's not made of anything else mass? And the answer is this kind of ghostly grey thing in the background here. The answer they came up with was we're going to do something quite radical. We're going to invent a new quantum field. We're going to fill the whole universe with it. And it's going to be a very special one such that even in a vacuum, even in empty space, this field is still there. So everything's a quantum field, really. Photons are quantum fields. But in the lowest energy vacuum of space, there would be no photons. There would be no electrons. But there would be this field that they've just invented. And because it's there, then, all the particles can interact with it, and mass becomes an interaction with this field. It's almost like they acquire inertia by sticking to this field, if you like. And that worked. They managed to generate mass for all these for these particles and make the theory hang together, which is great. But you've made quite a bold step there. You've filled the whole universe with a new quantum field, unlike any other quantum field anyone's ever seen, just to get the mass right. I don't know about you, but I'm an experimentalist. I'd like to know a bit more. I'd like a bit of evidence for that. So really, that's what we've been doing for the last 50-odd years. One of the things we've been doing, anyway. And the key to that is, you could ask yourself, how do we know whether this field is there or not? There are a number of ways. Ask yourself, how do we know? Well, there are a number of ways in general of detecting whether things are there. You could say, take a bit of the universe where it isn't and a bit where it is and compare them, look at the differences. We can't do that because it's everywhere. So, well, think one of the ways, for instance, that you know that there's air in this room is that you can hear me. It's only one of the ways, obviously, but you can hear me. If there was no air in this room, not only would you probably not be paying much attention to the talk, you wouldn't be able to hear me. And the reason for that is that because the air is there, it's a field, it's an atmospheric field, it can carry waves, it can carry excitations. I can make, my mouth makes a bit of it oscillate, that oscillate transmits to your ears, which detect it. You can do the same thing with this background field, this weird background field that's supposed to give things mass. If you hit it hard enough, you make it wobble, make a quantum excitation, and that would prove it's there. That's the Higgs boson. That wobble is the Higgs boson. the thing that hits it hard enough is the Large Hadron Collider. That's what we're doing. Okay? Now, that wobble, it's not like sound. It doesn't go forever. It doesn't travel too far. It decays very, very quickly, in about 10 to the minus 25th of a second. But it decays to things we can measure, and we can, from measuring them, deduce what happened and that this wobble was actually there or whether it wasn't there. There's one other, there's a nice analogy for how this this thing works. And this idea, I mentioned symmetries briefly, that somehow the theory has to not have this field in it, but yet in everyday life it's there in order to give things mass. And that's just a key concept in this whole thing called spontaneous symmetry breaking, which actually came from condensed matter physics. And this is an illustration of it from Heidelberg University. I gave a talk there. And they have this thing on the wall. Believe me, this is going to illustrate the Higgs boson. What this is a bunch of little arrows, which are all magnetic. Okay, so they're little magnetic dipoles with a north and a south pole. And on this one, this is an analogy of the hot universe. Everything's flying around all over the place. They're all in random order. And if you tweak one, it just stays where you put it, really. It might slightly move the ones next door to it, but it'll just stay where you put it, really, because it's... they're not far enough, they're not in any order, and it'll just, and if this was hot, which it really would be, they would all be jigging around as well, and it would just get knocked out of alignment again. So if two of them line up, they don't stay aligned. In this case, when they're all in a lattice and they're all in order, you can see they're all lined up. No one put them like that, they just do that, because all the forces, it's unstable such that two of them do line up, then suddenly there's a stronger force to make the next one line up. And because they're in a regular order, you get a long-range force that spreads through the whole thing. And the whole thing has north and south poles around it. So although this may look sort of symmetric to us, more symmetric to us, it's actually less symmetric because it's no longer... This one looks the same from all directions. This one looks the same from six directions, but only six. As you can see, that it's kind of hexagon shape. That's really very close to physics analogy for what's going on with the Higgs boson. This is the early universe, it's all very hot, there's no overall field because everything's disordered. As it cools down, this happens. It kind of freezes out. This happens with real magnets. I've actually done the demo with the Bunsen burner. You can do it with neodymium, it's brilliant. You see a magnetic field develop, and that magnetic field is the Higgs field, okay, the analogy of the Higgs field. And there's even an analogy of the Higgs boson in there, because if you twang one of these, you'll see a ripple go through the whole thing, and that's the Higgs boson. Okay, and it wouldn't happen in this case, but it would in this case. Okay. Now I'm going to show you the Higgs data, the real data, actually the thing that convinced us that we'd found this wonderful new particle, and therefore had some idea where mass came from. And to do that, I'm going to have to explain Feynman diagrams briefly. So bear with me. This is my Feynman diagram. This is, you've got to imagine time going along this direction. So what this is showing you really is you've got an electron and the antiparticle of an electron, the positron, coming in here. They annihilate here. They give you a photon, which is a wiggly line, and then it decays back again to an electron and a positron. Okay. This is actually the experiment we did first in the 27-kilometer tunnel. There's LEP was in the Large Electron-Positron Collider. We think of the most obscure names, don't we? Large Electron-Positron Collider collided. Well, it was large, and it collided electrons and positrons. Anyway, so this is how you describe it. And actually, Feynman, Schwinger, and Tominaga put together the first theory of quantum electrodynamics, the first quantum field theory, which is part of the Standard Model now. Feynman came up with this way of representing the equations, and every feature of this diagram represents a bit in the equation that you would use to calculate the probability of this actually happening in your experiment. And you can compare that very directly with what does happen, and it agrees very well. So, you know, there'd be a term for the way they join, there'd be a term for what comes in, what's in the middle, and what goes out again. So they're not just cartoons. They're very intuitive, but they're actually a representation of the real theory. Now, there's a problem with this. Because there's three important physical facts, all of which are true, so don't get confused about them, but which are in conflict in this diagram. So energy is conserved, okay? So you have a lot of energy here, you have a lot of energy here, because you put that in and you measure this coming out. So you must have a lot of energy here, okay? The photon has no mass. That's known very, very accurately. They travel billions of light years across the universe. They wouldn't do that if they had mass. So we know that. We also know, this is the only equation in the top, by the way, but we know that E equals mc squared. So if you've got to have a lot of energy here, and the mass is zero, you have a problem, because c squared, it might be big, but it's not infinite. So you have a problem. Where's the energy gone in the middle? Now, the way you get around that is a kind of weaseling of quantum mechanics, because you say we never actually measure this guy. What we do is measure what goes in, what comes out again. In the middle, at some level, anything can happen. And at some level will, with a non-zero probability. Now, the way we talk about this is we say that photon, because it's what we call, it's not a real photon, because we don't actually measure it. We call it a virtual photon, and we say it can have the wrong mass, very briefly. You can think of it as being Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, if you like, although it's built so deeply into these equations that this is more fundamental than that, really. But anyway, you think of the photon as having the wrong mass, very briefly, as long as it's not a real photon, it's okay. Don't get confused, though. Real photons don't have mass. So you might think there's still a remnant of the fact that photons should have zero mass in there, and that this is much more likely to happen if the photon can have zero mass. As you move it away from its correct mass, the probability of this happening drops really quickly. So this makes us look a bit silly, because we've put loads of energy in here to do something that's highly improbable, because we're forcing the photon to have the wrong mass by a long, long way. And the reason we did it was because there's another particle that can be in the middle there, which is this guy, the Z boson. It appeared on the standard model graphic I had before. It carries the weak force, and it has mass. It has a mass of 90 GeV, which is about 90 times the mass of the proton. So we collide these at 90 GeV. What do we see? We see this. This is one of the more important plots in physics, and if you understand this, you will understand the Higgs data, so bear with me. This along here is the energy of, or the mass, they're the same to within a factor of c squared. So it's the energy and the mass of the wiggly line in the middle of the diagram, okay? This vertical axis is just the probability of the thing happening. It's measured in some particle physics units, but it's essentially the probability of it happening. So you see the features that I described to you in this plot. You can see that if the mass of the thing in the middle could be zero, the photon's very happy. It's very likely to happen, okay? As you push it, as you increase the collision energy, it drops. The probability drops very, very quickly. This is a log scale, so it's dropping really quickly. Then as you get to 90 GeV, where the Z suddenly lines up and can satisfy all three things, it can have the right mass and satisfy E equals mc squared and satisfy conservation of energy all at the same time, there's a peak. The probability rises very quickly, and then as you go up again, it drops again. Okay? That peak there is the Z boson, and you could actually think of it really, that's how you discover a new particle. You have all these Feynman diagrams going on. If at some point you have the lovely coincidence of facts, of kinematics really, that you can have a particle in the middle of the diagram that can have the right mass and conserve energy and momentum, then you have a peak. If not, then it doesn't drop to zero, but it's suppressed by the quantum mechanics. Okay, now before I go on to the Higgs data, just to say this is some data from the LHC. This is that same thing happening again at some level, only in this diagram, where we have a quark and an anti-quark doing the same thing. And the reason I'm showing you this is just to show off, really, because this is the Z boson down here, 90 GeV, and we can go so much higher in energy. That's why we went to the effort of doing it. Now, the sad thing about that is there's no more bumps. These bumps are just made up, the black points of the data. These bumps are made up theory bumps that are always just a bit too high energy for us to rule them out. But if we ever do see a bump in this distribution, you will hear about it, believe me. But so far, we haven't. But there are other distributions to look at. Now, I mentioned this, the Higgs boson. Remember what it is? It's this excitation in the quantum field that is supposed to give mass to everything. It will be created very briefly. It will appear in one of those Feynman diagrams, if it's created very briefly. And it will have a definite mass. So if you can find a diagram that could have a Higgs boson in it, and you can plot the mass that would be the Higgs boson if it was there, then if you see a bump, then you found something. So the Higgs boson will decay to things we've seen that we can measure. One of the things it can decay to is a pair of photons, for instance. So this is one of the event pictures again. This is a slice through the ATLAS detector. Beams coming in here and from behind the screen, they collide. There's some fairly dull, lowish energy tracks here. The interesting thing in this plot is these two yellow blobs. which don't have tracks pointing to them because there's no charged particle pointing to them, they're just photons. They're very, very high energy quanta of light particles. And you can see, they don't look terribly impressive in this plot, but you can see in this histogram of the energies in there that they're hugely higher energy than anything else in the event. And they're kind of on their own out there. And you can do you can invert that event, if you like. You can say, okay, one of the ways you can produce a pair of photons like this, it might be that a Higgs boson was produced and decayed to three photons. Okay? Might be. We don't know the Higgs is there. We don't know what its mass is. But if it's there and it has some mass, then it can do that. And from measuring the energy and the angle of the photons, you can work out what the mass would have been. Okay? And you can just plot it. And you can do that again and again and again. Count all the pairs of photons you get. And if you see just a flat distribution, that just means you're getting all the other Feynman diagrams with no particular particle in there. But if you see a bump, then that means, like the Z bump, you've got a new particle. So here you go. 2 years of LHC running, 2 years of my life, flashing past. Same plot you've seen before almost, only with photons this time. This is the mass of the pair of photons. So it's the mass of the particle that would have decayed to them if it existed. This is the probability, and there's a bump. Okay. So, just, I'm going to run it again because it's great. So, as it does run, is it going to start again? Let me start it again. So, as it does run, you see the date here. This is the time that we were collecting the data, 2011, 2012. You see the noise, you see there's lots of false bumps that fade away as you get more data. These black points of the data, the error bars, show you the statistical uncertainty. You see us zooming in on it. And then finally, you see one of the bumps didn't go away and you run a fit on it and you see that the fit finds the bump. We announced this actually on the 3rd of July. We carried on taking data afterwards, as you can see, but we announced that we'd found a significant bump on the 4th of July. On the 3rd of July, I was in Geneva, and I watched Fabiola Giannotti, who's the head of our experiment, present to us the kind of practice talk for the day after, where she collected all the data we'd got. We'd only stopped taking data 2 weeks before, and some of the plots were very hot off the press indeed. It was fantastic, really, to see it and realise we'd found something very new. And then I had to fly back to England because I was supposed to meet the science minister, and they're having a big event in Westminster to celebrate the UK participation in this global exercise, which is great. No, it's an honour to be doing that at some level, but I'd rather have been the stern. I turned up there, and Jim Verdi from Imperial College, also in London, was there doing the same thing for CMS. I was doing the Atlas thing, he was doing the CMS thing. And we knew that once the show kicked off, early morning it was, once the show... I'm just leaving it running because it's so good. If you'd rather watch that, just watch it. Just before the thing kicked off, we knew that we would have no time to really watch. I have not seen the CMS data. We're completely independent experiments. He hadn't seen my data, I hadn't seen his. Of course we'd heard rumours, right? Everyone hears rumours. People talk to each other in the canteen. But we'd only got our final data the night before, so we certainly hadn't seen what CMS had got. And likewise, he hadn't seen what Atlas had got. So we weren't supposed to, it was all under wraps, of course, because the point of it is to do independent checks of each other. But anyway, the beginning of the day, you know, he showed me the CMS data and I showed him the Atlas data. And it really surprised me that was another moment of realization that we'd really found something, was when I saw the other guys had the same bump in the same place. Completely independent set of people, completely statistically independent data set, completely different detector technologies, different code doing the analysis, all good. And it was, I thought I believed it. I thought I'd already believed our data and I knew we'd got the Higgs, but actually it was another layer of certainty, I guess, when I saw the independent confirmation of it. And I'm sure Jim wouldn't like me to say that CMS were confirming Atlas, so I'm sure he felt the same thing when Atlas confirmed CMS. So I should have believed it, really, because there's more. We actually had more than just that one bump. In fact, the Higgs can decay other ways. One of the ways it can decay, this is a different representation of the collision, but you've got a pair of muons coming off here and a pair of electrons, and it can do that. It can decay to four leptons. And you can make similar plots. Again, the black points are the data. It's rarer events, but also lower background. And the red histogram is what you would get if there's no Higgs. And imagine watching this and getting excited when that point suddenly went on there. What's that? You know, what's this? Is this a Higgs? But then keep your eye on this one. And you can see that again, there's a bit there. There's a lot of noise in this data because the rare events, the bigger statistical uncertainties. But if you look at that, there's clearly a bit there where you don't describe that without a Higgs boson. You put a Higgs in, that's what you get. And CMS also, in fact, animated this one, so I'll show that because I like it. And one of the reasons I like this is that they put the answer in already. This is the Higgs growing here as it comes. But I still find these plots mesmerizing because we met all 3,000 people on each experiment, all that technology in the accelerator and in the beam, all that wonderful theory, trying to understand how infinitely small things can have mass, filling the universe with this crazy field, all boils down to, in the end, is there a bump in this or not? Right? And do we understand? Is there a bump where there shouldn't be a bump? And of course, there is in the end. And I remember watching these and agonizing, not fooling yourself and getting excited over every new point that comes in and then disappointed when it recedes into the background again. But in the end, that's what it boiled down to, two independent experiments looking for bumps. Okay, so finally, where are we now? I mean, now we've done it. We've got our bumps. Should we go home? I've already said that we're restarting the LHC, hopefully this week, at even higher energies. Now, you already know why even higher energies is potentially interesting, because it's going to be even shorter wavelengths, so we can see even smaller things. But we have this standard model, and it's full. There's nothing else on it. We've got all the particles. There's nothing else predicted. That's true. One of the things that we would like to do, though, we've just discovered the Higgs boson. What do we know about it? How sure are we that it's the Higgs boson? Well, we're sure enough that it is operating to give some of the particles mass that Francois Engler and Peter Higgs, and would have been Robert Brout if he died a couple of years too early, they all got the Nobel Prize for it in 2013. So yes, it's a Higgs boson, but we don't know a huge amount about it. I like this graphic. I don't know. I think it's this big worried Higgs that I like best. It's Ben Gilliland did this. But we know the Higgs is its own antiparticle. We've measured its decays to W and Z bosons. We've looked at all kinds of properties of it. But we don't know whether it gives itself mass. In fact, even more embarrassingly, we don't know really whether it gives quarks mass yet, because we haven't seen it decaying to quarks or leptons clearly. We've seen it decay to the tau lepton with some good evidence by now, but we haven't seen it decay to quarks yet. We don't know whether it's really fundamental. We haven't really measured how big it is as well as we have with the other particles. There are theoretical models out there where the Higgs is actually made of something else. We don't know whether it's alone or whether there are more of them out there. Maybe just the first one we've come across. There might be more of them. And also, we don't know along the bottom here. So we don't know whether the Higgs gives mass to dark matter. Now, dark matter. I lied. Actually, I said that this is what everything in the universe is made of, and it's not made of anything else. Now, the second bit of that is correct. As far as we know, these are fundamental, but actually, it's only about less than 20% of the matter in the universe, as far as we can tell. That's the astronomer's fault, really. But there's very good evidence from astronomical observations that when you look at a galaxy, you're only seeing a rather small fraction of its mass. You can tell that from the way the galaxies rotate. Really hot off the press is these studies of colliding clusters of stars, where you can, from the way matter bends light, you can see even the matter that isn't shining. You can still see where it is, and you can see the stars, and you can see the way dark matter bends light around it. It doesn't shine directly, but it distorts the light on the way to you, and you can work out how much there is there, and the gas in these things, and you can see how they collide and how they redistribute themselves as they collide. In fact, even from things like this, we're even starting now to learn things about how likely it is that dark matter interacts with each other. But what we do know, unfortunately, is that dark matter isn't one of these. So there's something else out there. It's probably a fundamental particle. It's hopefully somewhere not too far from the Higgs, because if the Higgs gives it mass, it shouldn't be hugely heavier than the Higgs, for instance. So we hope that that's true. So that's one missing thing. One big job to do. My personal favourite, actually. I really hope when we turn the LHC on, we find a good new candidate for dark matter. We would still need astrophysical observations and these very low, very sensitive underground detectors as well to prove that it was dark matter, but I hope the LHC gives them something to work on. There's another problem in here. Suppressed in this, really, is the fact that all these particles have antiparticles. And in fact, in the standard model, it's almost true that they're interchangeable. If you swapped every particle for its antiparticle at the same time, would we even notice? Now, the fact is, you would notice if you were a particle physicist and were doing some very precise measurements. Then you could tell from some rare decays that maybe we're in a universe of matter, of antimatter, not matter, or vice versa. But that's a bit subtle for the fact that the whole of the universe is full of matter. Where's all the antimatter? If the physics treats them roughly equally, always produces them in pairs, where's all the matter gone? Fact is, we don't actually know. It's probably connected to the fact, well, it is connected to the fact that there are three copies of this, because that allows a small difference to creep in. But we really don't know. Another one of those pictures from Ben. But we would notice if half of us were made of antimatter, right? It would be destructive. And we know actually from looking out in space that there's no sign that some of the galaxies are antimatter and others are matter. So that needs to be understood. I mentioned LHCb at the beginning. One of the things it's doing is looking at very rare decays to see if we can get clues, because you can get clues to this from some of them. We've seen matter-antimatter differences in the quarks, but we've not seen them in the leptons, and there are experiments now we know that neutrinos have mass, partly because of work done in Sudbury, which is just up the road, I was told when I came here. It was like 500 miles up the road, but never mind. We know they have mass, and there's now a possibility that they also may contain a matter-antimatter asymmetry, and there's a very active program of people looking for that, but it's still definitely an unanswered question. It's not answered within the standard model. And then there's the whole, the really big thing that you should have probably picked me up on when I said this was the whole thing, is where's gravity? It's not even there. And that brings a whole host of problems with it. Now, this is the last plot I'm going to show, but this is actually from the experiment I did my PhD on. What you're seeing, it's one of the plots very similar to the others. It's there's a probability of a particle scatter happening, and this is the mass of the thing that's doing the scatter. But in this case, you're bouncing electrons off a proton, smashing the proton up. And most of the time, the electron just bounces off, and that's the probability here dropping. And it's dropping for the reasons you already know, because the more and more energy that's swapped, the further and further the photon has to be from zero mass, so it's the probability drops. This one is when the electron transforms into a neutrino, which you can do because of the weak interaction. And you see it doesn't drop as quickly. And in fact, they merge. Yeah. And this means the weak force is sort of unified with the electromagnetic force. It's no longer weak. I mean, actually, they're both very weak, but it's no weaker than the electromagnetic force now. So we knew that happened. These points are data here. We knew that happened. We knew that that was actually to do with the mass of the particle, because for the reasons I've told you, it's to do with the reason this is dropping more slowly is because the W's got a heavier mass, a higher mass. And the reason they come together here is because the energy is so high that mass makes no difference anymore. So that's a unification of forces here, if you like. We don't know whether the strong force actually unifies as well, and we certainly don't know whether gravity unifies with them as well. But we do know that the gravity doesn't fit with the others at all, and we do know that having some big scale up here where gravity doesn't fit, and all this and this mass way down here, many orders of magnitude lower, causes huge problems within the theory, and there's a lot of people in this institute working on them. It's called fine-tuning problems. It makes the whole thing, or the hierarchy problem. It's very odd to have something around, say, 200 times the mass of the proton, and then nothing until you're billions of times the mass of the proton, and there's some desert in between. Looks very odd. It's theoretically possible within the theory, probably, but it brings all kinds of awkwardnesses and inconsistencies with it. So there's a lot of work going on there, and there are many theories proposed that kind of solve some of those problems. Supersymmetry is proposed to kind of make that big gap between the Higgs and the top and this unification scale here. Or the Planck scale, to make it more natural. But it's all a bit, well, as an experimentalist, I'm just watching and waiting to see if someone comes up with something I can measure. Let's put it that way. So, and just finally, one, just in case you haven't got the idea, that in case I realize I'm probably overcompensating now for the idea that I was giving you that we'd done it all and it was finished. But there's still even more unknown than all that stuff is the fact that the universe, having gone through a period of rapid expansion that gradually slowed down because of the mass pulling it back together again, is now accelerating in its expansion again. We only found this out a few years ago. We call that effect dark energy, but we really haven't got a clue as to why it's doing that. Well, we have several clues. We've got too many clues, actually. So we don't know what it is that's doing that, and that's another major open question. So matter-antimatter asymmetry, dark matter, dark energy, gravity, unification, and hierarchy problems. So we've still got plenty of work to do. One of the ways we might try and do this work is to build an even bigger machine. So this is a kind of the Large Hadron Collider, not looking quite as large as it did before, in Geneva. This is a possible, they've done geological surveys and we probably have the technology to build it, if the science case is there and if the money is there, to build an even bigger collider, which would go up to 100 GeV. There's a linear collider on here, which could collide electrons and positrons together. It could do a lot of very good exploration beyond that. I like this. This is standing on the ski resort on the Jura. This is the Large Hadron Collider, and this is the thing. It's ridiculous, okay? It may be that that's the right thing to do. To be honest, we don't know whether it is. These things take so long to plan that if you don't start planning now, the only assurance you've got is that you'll never do it. So people are planning it, but I would be silly to say that we know that either it's worth, the science we get from it is worth the money. We're looking for reasons to choose one option over another and these kind of things at the moment. Just to finish with, it doesn't always only get bigger. This is an accelerator as well. This is built by Stanford. This is an accelerator on a chip. It doesn't go to very high energy yet, but it does it very quickly and very efficiently. You have a little serrated structure in the chip, and you fire a laser through it, and it will pull an electron through it faster, at a higher accelerating gradient than anything we've had in the Large Hadron Collider. So if you could fill that linear collider with these, you might not need it quite as long, okay? Or you might get even higher energy. So I guess the story is CERN has had, CERN and World Particle Physics has had a more or less constant or even declining budget for the last few decades. Yet, because we keep inventing new technologies, manage to do more with the same resource, and also because we keep inventing new technologies, everyone else gets the benefit of that as well. So I hope I've convinced you that it's a very exciting time to be a physicist. I hope I have also convinced you that it's not the last very exciting time to be a physicist. Thank you.
That was great. All right, thank you very much. We'll open the floor to questions now. So we have a mic here in-house, and we already have a question. Please, go ahead.
Thank you for an informative talk. I'm wondering if you could elaborate on what they would be looking for with the dark energy. I mean, I've heard theories that they're looking at the boson decaying and producing a possible dark energy particle. Could you just elaborate?
Yeah, I think you mean dark matter rather than dark energy, though, right?
Because sorry?
You mean dark matter, I think, rather than
dark
energy.
Matter, yes.
Yes. So, so there are many theories as to what this might be. And in supersymmetry, there is a candidate, for instance, for dark matter particles. What you need is a heavy particle that doesn't interact much, so like a neutrino, really, but heavier. And if the mass it gets comes from the Higgs, then there's a fair chance that the Higgs will interact with it and could decay to it, and you would see it then. When I say see it, of course, you don't see it because it's just dark. So even in the LHC, you don't see it. But what it does look like is it looks like a neutrino. So you produce it probably in pairs, maybe singly if it's in supersymmetry. I don't know, it would always be in pairs. But it would you see an imbalance. So you see a lot of stuff going in one direction and nothing in the other. And that, because the detector completely surrounds the beam, you can measure what the missing momentum is. And that will tell you that you've got that something left. Now that something could be a neutrino. That's exactly how they appear in the detector. But we understand neutrino production very well. In fact, we measured it. The plot I showed you there was when electrons turn into neutrinos. So what we'd be looking for in the end is we'd be looking for unusual events with maybe too many quarks or too many electrons and a load of missing energy. And that's really what most of these searches are. And we unfortunately would not know for sure that it was dark matter because for it to be dark matter, we could show it was dark, and we could show it was new, not one of the standard model things. But for it to be really dark matter, it has to live as long as the universe. It has to be stable, basically. And all we can do is say it's stable enough to have left the Atlas detector before it decayed. So we would still need other observations. We'd provide a very good candidate that's not in the standard model, but we'd still need other observations to know whether it was really dark matter or not.
Okay. Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Let's go to the online audience. From the Twitter feed, at Dr. MEF, says, mass and electric charge are essential in all physics. Higgs gave the origin of mass. What is the origin of electric charge?
Whoa. the short answer is symmetry. So there's a really fundamental relationship between symmetries and conservation laws in physics. So for instance, the fact that the world is rotationally symmetric, there's no particular angle in the universe, there's no particular direction, physics looks the same in all directions, is actually related to conservation of angular momentum. And so that's a very fundamental mathematical principle. The theory that Feynman wrote down for electromagnetism is based on a symmetry. It's called a gauge symmetry. And it's actually to do with the phase of a quantum mechanical wave. So if you move all the waves along, say, by half a wavelength, physics looks just the same, because all the physics is to do with how they align up with each other. So what that means is that there's symmetry there. There's a conservation law associated with it. That conservation law is conservation of charge. And that means that, and that's how it's built into the theory. Whether that satisfies the, well, it's certainly as good an explanation as Higgs's of mass, put it that way.
I liked it. It was good. Also, from the Twitter feed, at Wayne McCracken, explain how a neutron contains a top quark that has more mass than a neutron as a whole.
Yep. It's the same reason the photon in the middle of the diagram can have the wrong mass. So the top in the neutron would have the wrong mass, and it would be very small. And what's going on inside the neutron is there are quarks and gluons in there. The gluon can split into a pair of quarks, and then if you don't do anything to it, they will just join back up again and carry on as a gluon. And that's a Feynman diagram. And in that Feynman diagram, the quarks have the wrong mass. They have zero mass. And even the top quark can do that. And you can tell they're there because if you smash the neutron in the middle, while that fluctuation is happening, you can start measuring them happening. But that's why a proton or a neutron can contain quarks which are on the face of it heavier than the proton or the neutron.
Thank you. Let's go to the in-studio.
Hi, my name's Mike. I struggle with the business of particles and antiparticles, mm-hmm. and I'm just wondering, what is the theoretical or experimental basis for us believing that antiparticles exist or might exist?
Mm-hmm. The experimental evidence is very workaday, in fact. We use them routinely. So the previous high-energy collider to the LHC was colliding protons with antiprotons. So we know how to make them. Actually, the trick is making slow ones and actually making antimatter. So there's an experiment at CERN making antiprotons and putting positrons with them and making antihydrogen, but it's very difficult because you have to slow them down. But typically, if you smash anything with high enough energy together, you'll produce antiparticles and particles in pairs. That's why it's puzzling there's not more of it around, actually. So there's good evidence for that. The theoretical motivation is actually arguably even stronger. In that if you, it came from Dirac, if you try and make quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, Schrodinger's equation, basically, work with relativity, then you end up being forced to introduce antimatter. It's very wonderful and weird. I mean, I can only just tell you that's true, but it is true. As an undergraduate, I've been through that maths and had that moment of revelation, and I can only imagine what Dirac felt like. Actually, he didn't believe the positron was there. I think he was a bit worried about it. But it was antimatter was predicted before it was found by that, so it's very fundamentally built into the theory of where you put quantum mechanics with special relativity. But as an experimentalist, yeah, we've seen it too.
Terrific. Let's take another in-studio question.
I just wanted to get your thoughts on the idea that the universe is not only expanding, but expanding at a very accelerated rate. Does that scare physicists when they're looking at gravity and saying, maybe we got this wrong, or maybe it's on a different dimension, or something like that?
I think they should have been scared already, because it's very clear that gravity doesn't work with the standard model, actually. There's no quantum theory of gravity. If you try and identify this dark energy thing with the vacuum energy of the universe, you suddenly realize the Higgs boson tells you there's so much energy per meter squared that nothing works anyway. So already there were problems that had to be zero or cancelled away. if anything, that it does make people more scared, because somehow they were happier with cancelling 10 to the power of 40 down to zero than cancelling it down to something not quite zero, which is what dark energy would be. So yeah, it's a revolution. It's a revolution in cosmology, and hopefully it'll lead to a revolution in understanding gravity and quantum mechanics. But we'll see.
Let's take one last question from the in-studio audience, and online audience, know that the online chat will stay open for another 30 minutes.
If physicists presume that at the beginning of the beginning of the universe, there was a larger amount of regular matter than dark matter, then why do now physicists presume that there's 80%, 90%, the universe is made 90% of dark matter and 10% of regular matter?
It's not an assumption. It's not a presumption. It's actually measured. At least if we understand gravity, which we've just decided we don't. But if we understand gravity properly and how it bends light, then we can see that. I mean, the most direct evidence that appeals to me is if you look at the way galaxies rotate, and this is the first way it was done. Then if the galaxies are only the stars, then the ones in orbit on the outside should be going much slower than they are. And they're not. They're going really. They're moving almost co-moving with the whole thing. And the simplest and only so far way we have of describing that is if you embed them in a big blob of dark matter. That already tells you it has to be a lot bigger than the rest of the galaxy. So it's not really a presumption. I think it's easy to see. I guess plausible to see how that, because dark matter doesn't interact very much. If you have a whole boiling mess of stuff. The stuff that interacts most will annihilate with each other and produce radiation, whereas the dark matter won't, and it will be left over at the end as the universe cools. So I think that comes fairly naturally once you've had to buy the fact that dark matter exists. But the fact that dark matter exists is not a theoretical presumption. It's an annoying experimental fact.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Jonathan Butterworth.